Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu, folks. Today, this afternoon, we are going to be talking about Fatimah bint Asad radiallahu ta'ala anha. Today's Sahabiyat that we are going to discuss has a very dynamic presence in the sense of her different relationships, rather, the different hats, or shall I say hijabs, that she wears as far as her relationships are concerned. So we are going to delve into that, inshallah, delve into her life story and seek inspiration, see what we can learn from another Sahabiyah amongst the team of the Sahabiyat, the female supporters and companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So without further ado, we're going to jump right in. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. I begin in the name of Allah, the most compassionate, the most merciful. Rabbi shrah li sadri wa yassir li amri wahlul 'uqdatam min lisani yafqahu qawli. And with that being said, I am also going to go ahead and share the PowerPoint presentation that I take the liberty of preparing and sharing with our with my audience every afternoon, every week on Tuesday afternoon. So today, folks, we are talking about Fatimah bint Asad radiallahu ta'ala anha. Let's see how that looks like in a full screen. All right, that looks wonderful. Who is Fatimah bint Asad radiallahu ta'ala anha? She is the mother of Ali radiallahu anhu. She is the grandmother, obviously, of Hassan and Hussein radiallahu anhuma. She is the wife of Abu Talib. And who else is she? We are going to find out. All right. Now, Fatima bint Asad radiallahu anha is counted amongst the earliest converts to Islam. Yes, folks, the wife of Abu Talib. Now, we're going to talk a little bit about Abu Talib as well, okay? Because she spent her entire life, Abu Talib spent his entire life with Fatima bint Asad. So we are going to definitely bring Abu Talib into the picture. Now, we know that Abu Talib did not die on the message of his nephew. He did not die with the message of Tawheed. He did not die with the message of Islam. Rather, he died on the message and on the way and traditions of his forefathers. However, his wife, Fatima bint Asad, she happens to be one of the early converts of Islam. Her number comes in around number 11. And after Khadija radiallahu anha, she is the second woman to accept Islam according to our sources and our scholars. Now, she is a Hashemite. What does a Hashemite mean? Someone who is a member of the Banu Hashim tribe. Who is Banu Hashim? Well, Banu Hashim is the great-grandfather of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now, she is also from the tribe of Banu Hashim. What's her lineage? Fatima? Well, her father's name was Asad and his father's name is Hashim. Just like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's father's name is Abdullah, and his grandfather is Abdul Muttalib, his great-grandfather is Hashim. So the grandfather of Fatima and the great-grandfather of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they both share that. And this is where their lineages meet up. Now, as I mentioned earlier, Fatima bint Asad was the wife of Abu Talib, who was the beloved uncle of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was the supporter of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was the protector of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now, Fatima is from Banu Hashim. Abu Talib is from Banu Hashim. So it is mentioned that she was the first woman from Banu Hashim to actually marry another member of the same tribe. Okay, this perhaps wasn't a tradition back then. This wasn't the case. So this is mentioned also when we talk about and when we study about Fatima bint Asad. Now, Abu Talib was a well-known and well-respected leader figure in his society. He was the son of Abdul Muttalib. Now, if you don't know about Abdul Muttalib, the grandfather of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was a very popular, well-respected, well-honored figure. He is the one who rediscovered the well of Zamzam. He is also the one who met face-to-face with Abraha, the tyrant Yemeni, Abyssinian general who advanced from Yemen with an army of elephants to destroy and annihilate the Kaaba. All right, so Abdul Muttalib had a very special place in the eyes and in the hearts of people, and Abu Talib, he inherited that. He was in charge of Siqaya and Rifada. What is Siqaya and Rifada? Well, all of the departments, all of these services, rather, all of these services that are provided to pilgrims of the Kaaba were divided into different departments, okay? And if any clan or tribesman was in charge of those departments, it gave that tribe honor and respect. It was not considered as a burden. Oh my God, now we got to feed all these people. It was considered an honor and respect. Now, Abu Talib was in charge of feeding and watering the pilgrims, making sure they have water, making sure their animals have water, making sure they have food. In spite of the respect that he won for his tribe by having the responsibility of this, he was poor. So we're talking about the financial situation of Abu Talib. He did not have enough money. He had a big family. However, his pockets may have been empty, but his heart was definitely full, and he was a very generous person. You don't get to carry out the office of feeding and watering pilgrims if you're a tight person. You have to be generous for that. Now, we're going to track back a little bit more away from Abu Talib, and now we're going to talk about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam for a bit. Why? Well, Abu Talib is the uncle of the Prophet, and there is a very important note and tidbit that we should keep in mind. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we all know, he was born as an orphan. He was taken into the care of his grandfather Abdul Muttalib. Abdul Muttalib showed much love and compassion for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was 8 years old, he also lost his grandfather. And now, after his passing, who was going to take care of the Prophet? Well, if you look at it, the eldest son of Abdul Muttalib should have, which is Al-Harith. However, Al-Harith was not wealthy enough to take him in. Another factor in that, which is not mentioned in this slide, Abu Talib was the full brother of Abdullah. So he shared Abdul Muttalib as a father, and they shared the same mother as well. Okay, so Abu Talib, in spite of his poverty, but being generous, he took over the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's care and upbringing. So in a sense, Abu Talib adopted the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now, we're bringing back Fatimah bint Asad into the picture. Abu Talib took over the care of the Prophet, which made Fatimah bint Asad radiallahu anha also the caretaker. And she treated him as one of her own children. And she was just like a mother to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this is also attested to by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself. He himself loved her and honored her as a mother, even used to address Fatima bint Asad, the mother of Ali radiallahu anhu. He used to address her as Ummi, my mother. All right. Now, who is a part of the household of Fatima? What is the makeup of the household? Well, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Fatima bint Asad. Abu Talib and Fatima had a total of 6 children, 4 sons, 2 daughters. The sons were Talib, obviously, you know, Abu Talib, right? So it was not necessary that every Abu is named after one of their sons. But in this case, for example, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu never had a son named Bakr. He was given that title for another reason. Abu Talib was given this kunya and title because of his eldest son Talib. After that, there was also an Aqil, there's also a Ja'far, and there's also an Ali. And by the way, between the second, third, and fourth son, there is a gap of 10 years in between each, according to scholars. The 2 daughters that he had were Fatiha, okay, not Fatima, Fatiha, okay? So Fatiha and my mom's Fatima, all right? Which is, she's also known as, aka Umhani. And number 6, her 6th child, 2nd daughter, is Jumana, all right? So this is the household of Abu Talib. Now, the financial situation, as I mentioned early, of Abu Talib, it was already bad, okay? But it went from bad to worse when a particular drought hit Mecca one year. Now, we know in the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam moved on from his childhood to his adolescence to his adulthood. And being a young adult, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam went from being a shepherd to being a broker to being involved in business. He also found himself taking care of a huge investment of Khadija radiallahu anha, and then they got married. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was in a much better financial situation prior to his own, and also in a better situation than his own uncle who took care of him, Abu Talib. So when situations went from bad to worse, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam hit up his other uncle Abbas radiallahu anhu, and he suggested that, you know what, let's take responsibility of caring for and raising one of his children. You know, let's take one of his kids each off of his plate. Let's raise them. Let's be responsible for their upbringing and all of their needs so that it can release some of the stress and tension and financial burden off Abu Talib's house. Abu Talib agreed, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam took the responsibility of Ali, okay, a then very young Ali, and Abbas took the responsibility of his brother Ja'far, okay, and Ali radiallahu anhu was taken care of by the Prophet, his cousin, and remained a part of his household, and later on eventually married the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's daughter, whose name was also Fatima. So Ali radiallahu anhu's mother and his wife, both of their names were Fatima, okay? Now, going back to Fatima the mother, okay? She, as I mentioned, she was one of the early converts in Islam, and she served as a great support for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We understand Abu Talib extended his protection and stood side by side, even though, albeit, he did not accept the religion, but he stood next to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, side by side, shoulder to shoulder, making sure no one could lay a finger on the Prophet. Now, likewise, Fatima bint Asad radiallahu anha, not only did she care for the Prophet as her son, but as the Prophet later on, she became a supporter of his cause and helped wherever she could. Not only did she help wherever she could help, she also accepted whatever fate came her way to support the cause of her nephew, as she was also a dedicated supporter of the deen of Islam. In the seventh year of prophethood, the Quraysh put a lot of pressure on Abu Talib. So, you know, the Quraysh was plotting. They were trying to put a lot of pressure on the Prophet and all of the other Muslims. We know how, you know, many of the Muslims were tortured. They were victims of hostility and bigotry and even, you know, physical harm. Some of them even actually paid the price of, you know, going through Shahada. They were martyred just because of their faith. So likewise, the Quraysh started to gang up on Abu Talib. Hey, hand us over your nephew. We need to execute him. Just hand him over and everything will be okay. Well, guess what? Abu Talib strongly refused. Okay? And what did he do? He gathered the tribes of Banu Hashim and the tribes of Banu Al-Muttalib. Okay? Al-Muttalib is the father of Abdul Muttalib. So Banu Muttalib is the brother of Abdul Muttalib. So both of these tribes were gathered, and he made them pledge that, listen, we have to support our fellow tribesmen. This is what tribalism is all about. If you look at it from the perspective of a pagan, right? These are pagans who are supporting their fellow tribesmen, who is none other than the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now, not all of them were pagans, but there were many in those two groups who pledged to protect the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There were many who did not follow the Prophet's message. Now, everyone was on board except for his uncle Abu Lahab. All right, that's where we get Tabbat Yada Abi Lahab. Now, we're talking about the sacrifices that the tribes and also Fatima bint Asad made. I want you to imagine the situation that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and both of these tribes were put in. Okay, keep in mind, this is the desert setup. This is a, you leave the outskirts, you leave the city of Mecca, and now basically it's all not just no man's land, but it's nomad's land, nomad being a Bedouin. So, you know, you in the desert, you need the support of your fellow tribesmen and other fellow tribes in order to survive. What did the Quraysh decide? Okay, you're not going to hand over your nephew? Tike, it's okay. The Quraysh decided to outcast both of these tribes by placing them under a social boycott and embargo. What did that mean? Nobody in Quraysh is going to do business with them. Nobody is going to socialize with them. Nobody's going to keep them company. No one's going to ask about their sick or tend to their elderly. None of that. All right. No one is going to be getting married into both of these tribes until they hand over Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now imagine that, right? You couldn't just go. Okay, so you have to buy or you have to trade in order to eat, in order to fulfill your necessities. When no one is willing to make a trade with you or do any transaction with you, where are you going to get your food? Where are you going to get your grain? Where are you going to get your necessities? Even if you have some, eventually they are going to run out. And here's another thing that they did. They also increased the prices on stuff to make it hard. They inflated the market for these two tribes. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, along with Abu Talib, along with all of the clan members of both tribes, along with Fatima bint Asad, they were forced to withdraw from their homes, from their places of residence, and they were forced to set up tent, set up camp, literally set up camp in a place called the Shi'ab of Abi Talib, the valleys of Abu Talib, which was a subsection right outside Medina. It's right on the outskirts of the Safa Marwa side. And in this image over here, you see that little circle. Okay, so you see the clock tower. And then you see that circle. This is where they were forced into isolation. Okay, this is where they were forced into isolation for not a month, not a week. Not a week, not a month, not a year. 3 years. This boycott was so devastating, and they lived through months of misery. And they were put under so much pressure. The food was so scarce, y'all, that they were forced to eat leaves off of trees. Now, this is the desert area, so you got very dry leaves going on over here to satisfy their hunger. Dry or moist, a leaf is a leaf. The woman and in particular, the children and the nursing babies would cry out of hunger, all right? And their cries could be heard all over the valley. Now, remember, at night, you don't have noise pollution. You don't have, there's no 75 cutting through Mecca. There's no horns. It's really quiet at night. And all over, people in Mecca could hear the babies crying, right? As I mentioned, prices were increased to prevent them from buying any essentials. And they stayed like this for 3 years. Now, what happened in these 3 years? Did they not see any food in 3 years? Well, apart from certain sympathizers from Quraysh who secretly brought them food, they were totally pretty much left on their own and abandoned. Now, as time unfolded, a group of fair-minded Quraysh, led by a person by the name of Hisham bin Amr, he hated this treatment. He was well respected amongst his people. He got together with some other men in Quraysh who would consider his proposal. He told them that, look, it's such a shame that we allow a group of our own people, right? The people that we know right close by, allow them to perish while we are eating and having a good time. So he, along with a group of people, he went and made a demand that, oh, people of Mecca, do we eat and clothe ourselves while the Banu Hashim are perishing, unable to buy or sell? By Allah, I will not sit down until this unjust document is torn up. Now, Abu Jahl, we know Abu Jahl, right? Abu Jahl became suspicious of this sudden rebellion. So Abu Talib, he came and saw this as an opportunity. He came into the precincts of the Kaaba, in spite of the fact that he was supposed to stay where he was. And he shared with the chiefs of Quraysh the revelation that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam received about that document. So as I mentioned, the Quraysh, they all got together. They agreed to put the tribes of Banu Hashim and Banu al-Muttalib in a boycott. So they ratified this agreement by putting it on a document, and they hung it in the Kaaba. So Abu Talib came and said, you know what? My nephew received revelation that that document no longer exists, okay? So they said, nah, you're lying. He was challenged, okay? Then Abu Talib challenged the Quraysh and said, you know what? Go and take the document out. If it exists, if it is intact, you can have my nephew. And if it's missing, then you need to end this boycott. Challenge accepted. Finally, when they were able to bring that parchment down, they noticed that it had been destroyed. Some insects had eaten that parchment. And the only thing that was left of that entire agreed upon document was the phrase, Bismikallahumma, in your name, O God. All right. So this was a sign to Quraysh from Allah to stop this boycott. So the boycott finally came to an end, but that was in no way the end of grief and pain and suffering for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Muslim Ummah at that time. When the boycott came to an end, another harsh test came for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And in essence, this was not only a test for the Prophet, but this was a test for all of the supporters of the Prophet to see their Prophet go through such a difficult time. Khadija radiallahu anha, the rock of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, after Allah, she passed away. And then shortly after that, Abu Talib, his strong supporter, also passed away. Both of these events, they weighed so heavy on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that this year was referred to as Amul Huzn. So the Islamic calendar starts from the Hijri date. That happens after the migration. So the first year, the second year, the third year. How do we recognize and organize the years prior to the Hijrah? Well, each year is given a title. And the year that was given to this, that the name given to this year was Amul Huzn, the year of grief. Now, as we know, and as I mentioned before, Fatima bint Asad, she proved to be a great support to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. She consoled and comforted the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam during this difficult time. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave the order for the Muslims to migrate, she was also from amongst the early ones to leave Makkah, to leave everything behind and go to Medina. Now, we're going to talk about the two Fatimas. Now, eventually, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam married his daughter to Ali radiallahu ta'ala anha. All right. Now, this, as a result of this marriage, now we have two Fatimas in the house. Okay. We have two Fatimas in the house. We have a mother-in-law Fatima and we have a daughter-in-law Fatima. But guess what? There were two more. And we get this from a narration. Once the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam received a large, expensive sheet as a gift. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam called Ali and said, you know what? Take the sheet and divide it amongst the Fatimas. So Ali radiallahu anhu went and he divided this sheet. It was a very soft, very comfortable, expensive sheet. Ali radiallahu anhu divided it into four pieces. Oh, where did the other two Fatimas come from? Well, apart from Fatima, the daughter-in-law, and Fatima, the mother-in-law, right? Fatima, the daughter, daughter-in-law, to her mother, Fatima, the mother-in-law. There was Fatima bint Hamza, one of the other uncles of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, had a daughter named Fatima. And Fatima bint Shayba, the wife of Aqil, Ali's brother Aqil, his wife, her name was also Fatima. So you have four Fatimas, a part of, you know, one direct household. Now, We're going to talk about the death of Fatima bint Asad. Fatima bint Asad, she never remarried after the death of Abu Talib. She dedicated her life towards taking care of her children, showing support to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam received news that she has passed away, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam immediately got up, went to her house, sat beside her head, and made the following statement, which was a dua for her. Rahimakillahu ya ummi. Oh, my mom, may Allah have mercy on you. You were my mother. Kunti ummi ba'da ummi. You were my mother after my mother. Subhanallah. You stayed hungry in order to fill my stomach. You sacrificed your clothing to clothe me. And you held tamna'ina nafsaki tayyiban. You withheld good things. You didn't enjoy good things, certain good things in life, so that you could feed me. And you did all of this for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Allah alone. Okay. Now, as a part of, you know, the story of her passing, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam also commanded, instructed the people who were giving her ghusl to wash her three times. And then when it came to the part where, you know, so one of the adab and the etiquettes of giving ghusl to a deceased is to use some type of fragrance. Either you diffuse some type of oil, they would infuse kafur or certain leaves that would provide a scent and an antiseptic effect. So, and I just happen to have a little bottle of essential oils right here. So when the part came for the using that scented water, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he used his own hands and poured it over himself. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam took his shirt off and offered it to Fatima bint Asad as a piece of her kafan. All right. And then it is also mentioned that when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when she was being lowered into her grave, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, tended to the digging of her grave personally. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, with his own hands, he leveled the dirt and the dust inside the grave. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam also lowered himself into the grave as Fatima bint Asad was being buried. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, also sat by her side in the grave as a source of radiance and nur for her. So subhanallah. Now it is because of this this act of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam giving his shirt as her kafan piece that she became known as the Sahibatul Qamis, the one who basically landed the shirt of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this is a fortune and gift that she is not alone in. There are a list of other companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam whom the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gifted an article of his clothing that he would wear, that he would use as a part of, to be included as a part of their kafan. All right. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that is mentioned in a narration, inni albastuha qamisi litalbasa min thiyabil jannah. I have granted her my shirt so that she can be granted a shirt from Jannah. All right. And I accompanied her in her grave so that the stress of the grave may be lightened upon her. إِنَّهَا كَانَتْ أَحْسَنَ خَلْقِ اللَّهِ إِلَيَّ صَنِيعًا بَعْدَ أَبِي طَالِبٍ. She was the most compassionate from amongst the creation of God towards me after my uncle Abu Talib. So folks, we see from this and we learn from this the rank of Fatima bint Asad radiallahu anha. Now, we learn a lot about Fatima bint Asad radiallahu anha. We learned about her compassion. We learned about her love and caring for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We also learned about her support for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam before Islam, her compassion before Islam, and her compassion for Islam after Islam. We learned how she stood by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in support, not just to take care of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but also to absorb and accept whatever wrench or whatever test that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put the Muslims through, including the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam at that time. And we also learn from this how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam reciprocated the compassion for his own, what he addressed her as, the mother. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it is mentioned in riwayah that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would go visit her a lot, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would go to her house and he would nap in her house. So they were very close, they were related, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we learn, you know, just as we learn and we are inspired, about Fatima through Fatima bint Asad, we also understand the relationship between the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and someone who took care of him. This serves as a lesson for us as well, that, you know, we should also extend a courtesy and kindness and compassion to anyone in our life who has shown us ihsan, who has favored us, who has showered a favor upon us. It's very important for us to be nice and to be good towards those people. There are riwayat from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There is a narration to the effect that, you know, it is a part of being dutiful to one's parents to be good to their friends after the parents or after the father has died, okay? The people who used to, you know, bring smiles on the face of your father or your parents, you should be good with those people. So overall, it's about maintaining family relations, family ties. We see Fatima bint Asad radiallahu anha, she was well respected and well honored. Whenever the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would meet her, he would stand up out of respect and honor for her. All right. So we see from this the honor and respect of Fatima bint Asad. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us even a glimpse, even a portion, even a part of the compassion, love, and courage and bravery that they showed and displayed, and the support for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Deen of Islam, folks. Thank you very much for joining me this afternoon. As I mentioned, we went over the life of Fatima bint Asad radiallahu anha. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept everything from us. Thank you very much. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.